Well, thank you very much, and thank you also for inviting me again in this nice place. I'm going to discuss distributions of algebraic integers. Well, recall what is an algebraic integer. It is a number, I will view it in C, which satisfies an equation of the type xn plus an, xn minus 1 plus and so on, plus an is 0, where the ai are in Z. In other words, it satisfies a polynomial equation, a unitary polynomial equation P of x is 0, unitary, harmonic, as you like, with coefficients in Z. And I would be interested in package of solutions of such an equation. And so that means, in practice, a set or a multiset of algebraic integers which is stable under Galois action. What Galois action? Well, the obvious one, that is, these elements are not only in C, but they are in the algebraic closure of Q in C. And on that, you have an action of the Galois group gamma Q is Gal Q bar over Q. And you are interested in subsets which are stable by gamma Q. I will be especially interested in the following. You give yourself some subset X, well, not of itself, that would be too easy, but of C. That would be compact in practice. And I'll be interested in algebraic integers. X, which are totally in X. And that means that all their conjugates equivalent to all their conjugates, Galois conjugates, not only complex conjugation included, but also my conjugates are in X. In other words, you're interested in polynomials, P of X, of the type here, unitary coefficient in Z, such that all the roots are in X. And we are going to see how these roots can be distributed. If we take an infinite set of such X, what kind of distribution we have? So before explaining that, let me give you just a very standard example. So Kronecker. Example. Kronecker example is K equals a set of elements Z in Z in C of absolute value at most 1. And in that case, he showed that the only integers with this property are the obvious one. What are the obvious one? Well, certainly zero is this is my x. Yes. My x. I think that is the notation I chose. Usually I call it k. So 0 is certainly in x, and is totally in x. And also the roots of UDT. Are like that, and that's all. That Kronecker proves that, nothing else. And you can translate this in a different set, because in what I will be working with, I'll be more interested in the case where X is in R instead of C. Those are called totally real. Algebraic integers. But there is a simple way to go from one to the other. If you have this, in this situation, for instance, if you take an X with this property, you take Z plus Z bar, and it's also an algebraic integer, but then it is totally real because it is in the interval minus 2, 2. And conversely, if you have an element here, you can write a quadratic equation and you get an element there. So if you take an A in this thing, then you write the equation Z squared minus AZ plus 1 is 0, and then you find an element here. So you have a dictionary between the elements which are totally integer in the disk and those which are totally integer inside that. Now, before talking about equipartition and such, let me tell you what are the examples I am interested in. They come from several branches of mathematics. The one I started with was the following. Suppose you have a curve. Well, first you get Q, a power over prime. And you take a curve over Q, a smooth, the usual thing, smooth, complete, absolute, geometrically connected. And you look at the number of, you look at the, well, the zeta function, in fact, or what is, what is the same? You look at the number of points, over FQ. And then it is well known that it's written like this. It's equal to 1 plus Q minus by 1 plus pi to G. G is the genus. Where the pi I are the so-called roots of Frobenius. They are not defined by this equation alone, but they are defined in a different way. They are roots of Frobenius, and they are the property that they are algebraic integers. That they are Galois stable. In a sense that an element of gamma q gives a permutation of them. And they have absolute value, that is the theorem given by Weyl, q one half. In other words, they are totally in the circle Z is Q one half. And if you play the game I explained with Z plus Z bar, you translate them into numbers which are traditionally called with the letter A, A1, AG is pi I plus pi I bar. Complex conjugation is a permutation. And those A's, without any absolute value, are in the segment 2q1/2. And the game one wants to play, which has been played, I should say, by Zwassmann and Bladut about 20 years ago, something like that, is you take a sequence of curves of genus gi goes to infinity, and you look at the repartition of the Frobenius. And one remarkable thing in that case is that on the circle, you will find that you have elements a bit everywhere. A bit everywhere needs a definition. So let's go to that. No, but before I give that definition, let me give you other example. The one I was interested in myself to start with was to generalize what Zwassmann and Bladut had done, because here you could restate it in terms of the Jacobian of the curve. The roots of Frobenius are defined in a more natural way in the Jacobian. They are the roots of the characteristic polynomial. But the Jacobian is an example of an abelian variety. And for an abelian variety, you have exactly the same situation. That is, you have a number of elements like that. And I wanted to see in what form Schwarzmann Vladut generalized to abelian varieties. And as you will see, the answer is they do not. The situation is much more amusing, interesting on abelian varieties. But another source of example is a theory of graphs, graph theory. Suppose you have a finite graph which is, let's say, K-regular. K-regular, K is an integer. K-integer. At least two. And K-regular means that if you start from a point P and you look at the at the edges starting at P, there should be k edges for each point, for each vertex. So if you want a nice looking one, you can take the Petersen graph, for instance. You start with 5 points, you copy them down, so you get 10. Here, and then you join them in a pentagon, but those inside, you take the other type of pentagon, and then you add that. That is a Petersen graph, which has 10 vertices, and it is a 3-regular graph, because starting from one point, you have 3 edges. Two regular graphs are not very interesting because, well, they are not so stupid, but this is a two regular graph, but you can hardly do anything else. You see, that's it's a sum of things like that. Now, when you have a graph, there is a natural matrix adjacent matrix, which is the matrix where you take for indices of the lines and columns, you take the vertices, so the and then APQ is a, where P and Q are vertices, is a number of edges joining PQ. And it is a symmetric matrix with coefficients in Z, of course, positive even, positive or zero. I'm not in France. In France, I would say positive. And that defines a matrix, and the roots of the matrix are real, of course, because it's a symmetric matrix, and they all belong in the interval minus k, k. And here the game would be, which this game has practically never been played, to my surprise, to take a sequence of graphs, you fix k, but you make the number of vertices go to infinity, and you look at the distribution of the eigenvalues inside this interval. As far as I know, it has been done only in two cases, the case of the so-called generic graph, where you get a precise distribution, and other less interesting cases. So now, what is the language to study such distributions? It is a language of measure theory. So we fix, as before, the set, the compact set X in C, and we have the notion of a measure on X, and I will be interested in measures which are positive and mass 1. And the most concrete way to see them is to say that you take the real functions on X, and you define a measure as a map mu into R, and the axioms are remarkably are extremely simple. The axioms are: it should be a linear form. Mu is linear. You want that F positive implies mu of F positive. And this is, the measure is positive. And you want mass 1. If you integrate the function 1, you find 1. Oh, and of course, you accept to write mu of F, you write it some like this, usually, mu of X. But you also write it sometimes F mu. Well, mu is an element of the dual of this Banach space, in fact. So that is a convenient language. The main point being that if I take a point X0 in X, it defines a measure, the Dirac measure, delta in X0, defined by the condition that a function f goes to f to X0. We will need that because of the following. If we have a polynomial P, if P is a polynomial with roots of some degree n, and roots x1, xn, they don't need to be distinct, it doesn't matter. Then we will attach to it a measure. We will attach to it the measure delta, which I write delta p, which is what you can say, the delta of x1 plus delta of xn. So that is a way of defining an object. And what is the advantage of this point of view? It is that the space of all possible measures has a natural topology, the so-called weak topology, so weak but quite good too, very useful one. So weak topology is mu n goes to mu if mu n of f has for limit mu of f for every f in C of x. There is another topology, a strong topology, but it will not play much role, and not in what I will say. And the interest of the... So let's give a name, let's say Mx, to be the set, or rather the space, of all measures on x which are positive mass 1. And because x is compact, this space is itself a compact metric space. Compact is very important for what we are doing because we are going to have to look at the following. I told you we take sequences going to infinity and so on. Yes, but it's much simpler to state in topological terms. That is, for every polynomial P of the type I wanted, that is the type where they are unitary coefficients in Z and the roots are in X, all of them. Then I have, by this construction, a mu P, delta P. I have a delta P, which is a measure, so it is in the set Mx. And then, instead of extracting sequences and so on, I can just say that I am interested in M. I call it big M like that, index x, equals the closure of Mx. And because it is a metric space, that means all the possible limits, but I think it's much more agreeable to view it in these terms. It is more agreeable especially because because of the following. What can be the properties of Mx? Well, Mx is of course closed, so it is compact. But it's also convex. Convex, you remember what that means, so you have two points, the segment should be in it. And to prove something is convex, it's enough to prove the mean value, the middle point is, because by adding, and here, where's the middle point? If I have a polynomial P1 and another P2, if I take with any exponents, in fact, integer exponent, this is also a polynomial of my type, and the roots are, and you get something dense in the segment. So it's obvious that it is convex, but it's a useful property. Now, in that language, let's take for X the circle. Z is 1, and let's use Kronecker theorem in order to see what we have for measures. I've told you that the roots are roots of unity. So, for instance, delta 1, so I'm taking equal 1, it's more interesting. So delta 1, the Dirac measuring 1, is certainly there. Delta minus 1. Now, next 1 would be 1 half of delta I plus delta minus I. You're forced to take minus I together with I, and so on. That is, you are going to find for every n, you will get something which I should call delta phi n, that is the delta attached to the polynomial, to the cyclotomic polynomial, phi n. So here I've written, for instance, x squared plus 1 for n equals 2. So, so you get a sequence of those things. And what else do you get, you see? It's not obvious a priori. But if you look at the circle and you take a very large n, you're going to find points almost everywhere. If I took all the roots of xn minus 1 is 0, I would really find the regular polygon, so to speak, degree n. Now here you find a little less, but you can convince yourself, that is, you can prove, that if you have a sequence of ni going to infinity, then the corresponding measure, delta phi ni, goes to the obvious measure on the circle, the rotation invariant measure, goes to the mu of the circle invariant measure. If you write a z through the form EI phi, then that measure is d phi, except that you have to normalize it for norm, for mass 1. So these are the obvious measures you find, and it is easy to prove the following, that the structure of, in that case of MX, it is a kind of simplex, an infinite simplex. An element here can be written in a unique way as a point in the following form. Sum ci delta I plus c0, this one, this mu, where the ci are real numbers, positive, and the sum is 1. So this is a convergent series. Even better, this piece is convergent for the strong norm, but that one only for the weak one. And there is a unicity, unique decomposition. So you have a description and a corollary of that. Is about the support. I did not tell you what the support of a measure is. but it's important. So the if mu is a measure, the support of mu is the, let's see, is it smaller or larger set? No, smallest. Smallest. Closed set, such that if phi is zero, outside, we close it F. Outside F, then mu of F is zero. Do I have it right? Well, if it is not right, it's something like that, but it's something just as simple as that. So that it, and the way you see it is that your measure is concentrated on F, it's supported by F. The integral depends only on the restriction to F. And F is the smallest for that. And so, on this formula, you can see what the support is. The support is the following. If all ci are zero except finitely many, then the support is finite, and it is a set of roots of the phi I. But if infinitely many ci are non-zero, the support is a full circle. So you get a very interesting division of case. And by the way, in Strassmann-Vladut, that is for curves or for Jacobian variety, what they found is that the support is always the full thing, that is always a circle. In that case, z equals q 1/2. That is, you take at random a sequence of curves over fq, you look at the distribution of the Frobenius, you extract a subsequence so that it converges with something, but that something has to have support the full thing. So I was interested to see what happens in the general case. And for instance, whether one can get a Cantor set. And the answer will be yes. Yes, you can get a Cantor set. But I have to explain now, the shape of the result will be very much like in the special case of Kronecker. That is, we're going to find that, so we take an arbitrary x now, x compact in C. Well, let's assume not empty, because there is not much to say if it is empty. So let's assume that. And then we are going to find that the corresponding mx, mu in x, that the support of mu is either finite or large. Large, I will have to define the term. It will be large, i.e., its capacity is at least one. And so I have to enter into capacity theory. It is an essential part of the game. So I have to recall some definitions. About capacity. Capacity is a kind of measure theory, but not quite a measure, in the sense that, for instance, if you take two pieces which are disjoint from each other, the capacity is usually much larger. For instance, if you take two very small pieces, very far, you get an enormous capacity. So what is the definition of the capacity? There are three or four definitions, or even more, but let me give you two of them. The first one, it is called also in the literature transfinite diameter. That's a nice name, and not really justified, because there is nothing transfinite in it, but infinite would be correct. It is an infinite diameter. And people write it sometimes, the infinity of x, if x is z. And the definition is the following. You define a sequence of distance. The usual distance, you could say that is d2 of x, is equal to the sup for xy in x of x minus y. Okay. Now what should be d3 of x? Well, it is a kind of of discriminant. You see, you take sup xyz in x of x minus y, x minus z, y minus z, and then you make it homogeneous of degree one, because so that there are three terms, so you put on that a 1/3. And you keep going. And it is a fact that the infinity of x is a limit, there is a limit. In fact, they are decreasing. D2 is larger or equal to D3 and so on. And the limit is that. It's not an easy thing to compute. In fact, you see, the simplest example would be to take the segment 0, 1. So it's an exercise in analysis. D2 is easy, it's 1. But well, D3, you would have to compute a little more. And the general case, it's a complicated formula, which was given It was given by Stiglitz. I don't remember the date exactly, but it's around 1880 something. And with no proof. It was a compte-rendu note, and he just said. And he also told you for the segment 0,1, he told you what is the optimal. He computed each dn. He did not make that, but also he told you what is the optimal position for every n of the roots. It's not obvious, it is not at all taking the ones in the middle. And a proof was given by Schur around 1910 something. A beautiful paper that you will find in Schur. I don't remember if it is in the collected works, volume 1 or 2. And if you use that, then for the interval, you will find that the capacity, so this d infinity in that case is equal to 1/4. So you see, it goes down a lot. It is equal to 1 here, and then it ends up with 1/4. So in general, the capacity, I prefer to write it cap. Cap of segment is the length of the segment divided by 4. So if you want capacity at least 1, for a segment, it is length at least 4. And you see, the Kronecker case, it's exactly 4. But there is a second definition which is even more useful, which is a kind of continuous form of that. Because if you take the log of this, you're going to realize that this is a mean value. This is a kind of discriminant. But the log of the discriminant, it's a kind of mean value of the function x minus y. See, because here, if I had put indices, I could have written it x1 minus x2, x2 minus x3, x3 minus x1. And then you would see that, in a sense, I am making a mean value of x minus 1. Why? So the other definition is the following. Cap of x is that the n for the sup? I think it is a sup, of course. Yeah, it has to be the sup. Yes. Sup over mu mass one positive and supported by x. The sup of what? Of the integral over x cross x, so it's really a double integral, of log x minus 1 mu y. Now that requires a little explanation, because the way I told you what is a measure, I told it for a continuous function. Now, log of x1, log of x, in fact, or log of z, let's write log of z, is a continuous function, but taking values in R union minus infinity. Not plus infinity, we don't have that, but minus infinity. And then how do you define the integral of such a function? Because it's not in the game. So what you do is you truncate it. You truncate that function. That is, you take for every n, on the graph, it's rather log of z is like this, absolute value of z. So you truncate it here at some minus n, and then you get a continuous function. You take its integral, and then you make n go to infinity, and take the limit. And there is a limit. But the limit could be minus infinity. So this thing is also id r union minus infinity. Okay, so this is the definition, another definition of the capacity. No, sorry, that's the log of the capacity. So the capacity is exponential of this thing. And also, it's a nice theorem that there is unicity for the best possible mu. See, if this number is not minus infinity, if cap is not zero, then there exists a unique measure mu such that you have equality, such that this integral of log x minus 1 mu x mu y is maximum. And it is called, for physical reasons, it's called equilibrium. I'm not sure I can pronounce that correctly. Equilibrium measure. All right. So now I have defined, well, it is a theorem, not very difficult, but this was done in the around 1926, about, so not so long ago. Well, I think I was born, but barely, really. Fekete Zege. So Hungarian mathematicians did that. And so you have to prove that the two things are the same. And when you have done that, then when, I can remove the quote marks, and then either finite or its capacity is at least one. So an example of that is the following. The corollary, which I think was noticed by Fekete, I think. Corollary, if x is a segment, an interval, of length less, strictly less than 4, then there are only finitely many algebraic integers which are totally in the interval. Because if there were infinitely many, you would take a limit and then you would get a support which would not be a finite set. And this is not trivial to prove. And of course it raises two questions. In what sense is it optimal? Well, it is almost optimal. That is, if the length is 4, then the interval, if the interval is of the form z plus 4, where z is in z, then of course there are infinitely many. Because you translate it by z, which is in z, so it doesn't change the problem, and then you end up with minus 2 plus 2, and then we have seen the Kronecker situation. We have the sum of roots of unity. If z is not in z, as far as I know, it's completely open. That is, there is no counterexample. No, I don't think any case has been solved. I mean, the first one you would be interested in would be, say, zero, and not zero, but one half and 9/2. That seems a difficult question. Now, length bigger than 4. Ah, that is very nice theorem of Robinson. Date, I think it's 1962, but I'm not completely sure, around 1962. The answer is yes, infinitely many. Of course, even when you find when you have such a nice result, you're not totally satisfied because there are many measures which have support the full thing, and which ones can be obtained this way. So Robinson did not say it, but his proof. Showed that the equilibrium measure of the segment is in what I called before Mx, that is, it's obtained by algebraic integers. Or that equilibrium measure you can write, but okay, if the interval is AB, it is something like, and you call T the variable, it's something like, I think, square root of. B minus T, T minus A, dT, and then something to make the integral equal to 1, some pi, and probably, no, I think it is in denominator, if I remember. Ah, yes. It is something like that, square root of T minus B. A minus T, maybe with 1 over pi, or maybe 2. I don't remember which one. But it's a very explicit thing. But I have an open question. Well, I have a question which seems to be open. Well, the field is full of open questions for one good reason, is that nobody worked on it before. I don't know why people did not seem to have the idea of looking at all possible limits. You see, they were always saying, oh yes, I take this sequence of curves or this sequence and then I get this nice distribution, but they never ask themselves, what are the possible ones? So I tried to do that. But as far as I know, the Lebesgue measure which is this notation would be dt up to a factor of the length. Is it in mx when x is a. My feeling is that it is never there. But certainly the segment has to be of length bigger than 4. I can give arguments so that the length is at least 4.8, but no, I don't believe it should be. But I don't see how to prove something is not. Well, Robinson's theorem was for intervals, segments, intervals. But 2 years later, he solved it. That was even more remarkable. So Robinson, and I'm pretty sure of that in 64. It took the following. X is an union, a finite union, finite of intervals in R and capacity of x bigger than 1. And then he showed that this implies there exist infinitely many integers, algebraic integers, totally in X. Let's see, do I have, don't have much time. Because I have a choice in explaining why the capacity is at least one, it's a rather simple argument. And Robinson's theorem, which is remarkable but more difficult. But I should have told you that what I'm telling you here, I told in a very different way in a Bourbaki seminar. In March, and it is on the lecture is on the web. The text is not yet given for print, but the lecture can be, and so you will find proof there. But let me explain rather the idea. I mean, so this part is really easy, and it is my part. And this one is hard and interesting, and it is Robinson's proof. The difficulty, let me explain it when you have two intervals. So, what do you want? You want a polynomial. You ask many things. You ask it is a unitary polynomial. That's not much to ask. Coefficient is z. But you want all the roots are there, and you want a large degree polynomial with distinct roots. See. So you want something, if the polynomial has even degree, its shape will be something like this. You don't care what it does here. And with exactly the right number of roots inside your, no root outside, and no complex roots. So what Robinson does is first to make up interesting polynomials with real coefficients, which have their roots there. They look like Chebyshev polynomials. That is, they look like Chebyshev inside this interval, but typically outside, they do something like that, and then they go up to infinity. And those are obtained by the Pell-Abel equation. Everybody knows the Pell equation x squared minus d, y squared is 1. And Abel had the idea to look at the analog of that, where you replace z, z is an equation over z, but you replace it by k of t, where k is a field. For Abel, k is a field of complex numbers. So x, d, so d is a given polynomial. Here d will have zeros, the extreme points. So here d would be t minus a1, t minus a4, where A1, A4 are the extremities. And you would ask for a polynomial x, a unitary of large degree, with this identity, so x of t squared. And if you want it unitary, you need to put not one, but a number, a positive number. Robinson writes it like that. And now the difference with the Pell equation, which has always solutions, is that the Pell-Abel does not. Abel noticed that, and he gave a criterion in terms of continuous fractions for the equation to have a solution. But if you change a little bit the coefficient by epsilon, you can manage to be in the Pell-Abel case. And you can reduce a little bit, because your assumption it was capacity strictly larger than one. So if you reduce a bit, it's still okay. So you assume you have that polynomial. So it is very nice, especially it's the way it undulates. It undulates from the same, the maxima and minima up to sine are exactly the same, this m and minus m. So here it will be woo, it does something, and then it's... The way to understand it is to write it as a cosine function here, here also, and here it is a hyperbolic cosine, cos h. So it's interesting to see that. And then the next steps, the next steps are quite amusing. It is when you have something real coefficient, how do you make it with integral coefficients? Well, rational coefficients is the first step. That's not hard, you just move it a little bit. What is surprising at first is how to approximate real numbers by integers in such a way. And the solution is that if your numbers that you are approximating are very large, then modifying by an integer doesn't change them by less than 1/2, does not change them very much. So what you do is you use a solution of the Pell-Abel with very large coefficients. And you can do that because they make a group just like the units of a number field, make a multiplicative group. Here also, you have a group structure, and then you can make the nth power of a solution, and then that gives you something with very large degree and very large coefficients. Okay, then I stop there. Mm-hmm.